Hello, my name is Osama Naga. I will discuss in this section the limping child. My objectives in this presentation is to gain an understanding of the normal and abnormal pediatric gait patterns, distinguish between septic arthritis and toxic synovitis of the hips, recognize orthopedic emergencies, understand and differentiate between the following causes of limp: developmental hip dysplasia, leg Calvé-Perthes disease, and slipped capital femoral epiphyses. Formulate a differential diagnosis of the limping child based on the patient's age. You can follow me in the Pediatric Orthopedics, a handbook for primary care physicians. This book was published in 2013 by Dr. Abdel Gawad, who is the chairman of orthopedic department at Texas Tech University, and myself. The chapter Approach to a Limping Child, page 485 to page 492. In order to assess a child with limping, we need to know the normal gait patterns and variations in children according to the age. In toddlers, normally, they have poor balance and immature motor planning. So when they walk, they have wide base of support, short and sometimes asymmetric steps, occasional foot slapping as they pick up speed, arm motion is non-reciprocal with their legs, they fall frequently. Between 3 and 5 years of age, they have symmetric strides, reciprocal arm motion, and overall improvement in motor development. 7 years and above, they have adult walk. I will give some examples of abnormal gait patterns. The first one is antalgic gait. Antalgic gait is limping due to pain in the lower extremity or the back. The characteristics of antalgic gait is shortened stance phase. Stance phase is the time the limb is in contact with the ground. And in this case, because it's painful, it will be shortened, it will be less than the healthy side to minimize the pain. If the pain is severe, the patient will not be able to bear weight at all. So it depending on the severity of the pain. So antalgic gait is shortened stance phase on the affected side. It's because of pain in the lower extremity, anywhere in the lower extremity, hip, knee, ankle, or foot, or even the back. Two important causes of antalgic gait is trauma or infection. Toe walking or tiptoe walking is common in pediatrics. In this case, initial contact occurs at forefoot instead of heel. This can be because of heel cord contraction or ankle muscle imbalance. This can be associated with multiple conditions. That's why it's very important to be evaluated, especially if it persists beyond 2 years of age. Examples: habitual toe walking, tight heel cord or idiopathic heel cord contracture, clubfoot, limb length discrepancy, cerebral palsy, or Duchenne muscular dystrophy. In cerebral palsy, the reflexes will be exaggerated and associated with hypertonia. Duchenne muscular dystrophy will look for Gower sign and elevated CK. Trendelenburg gait is a limping because of weakness of abductor muscles. If you look at the normal person during a single limb stance phase, the right side here in contact with the ground, this is the stance phase, and the abductors here are normal, able to maintain and able to support the pelvis in the opposite side and to maintain a level pelvis. If you compare that to the person with a weak abductor muscle on this side, on the right side, during a stance phase on this side, the abductors here are weak and will not be able to support the pelvis in the opposite side and the pelvis will drop. And to compensate, the trunk or the body will shift the weight to the affected side to maintain balance, and this is called lurch. So the body will lurch to the affected side. Possible causes of Trendelenburg gait: slipped capital femoral epiphyses, DDH, Perthes disease, muscular dystrophy. Scissoring gait is excessive hip adduction in a swing phase, and this will cause the knees and thighs to hit or cross, And this is commonly associated with cerebral palsy in patients who have spasticity and contracture of hip adductors. Circumduction gait. This is a stance phase. This is a swing phase. So during swing phase, the longer limb circumducts, means it swings around and to the side to clear the ground and move forward. As you see here, this foot is the stance phase. This foot is the swing phase. Instead of moving forward, it will circumduct. It will swings around and to the side. This can be caused by structural or functional limb length inequality or even foot pain. History is the most critical part in assessing a child with limping. Acute causes of limping in children can be as simple as a splinter in foot to more serious causes like malignant neoplasm or even life-threatening like cases of leukemia. Ask about history of trauma, sports, pain, recent infections like in case of transient synovitis or toxic synovitis, fever like in case of infection, travel like in cases of Lyme disease, rash like in case of Lyme disease or leukemia, weight loss. Very important to know that growing pain never associated with limping. If the limping is long standing, the most likely underlying condition is neuromuscular or rheumatologic. Ask about perinatal history like cases of hypoxic ischemic encephalopathy. Gait pattern like scissoring gait or tiptoe walking can be a manifestation of cerebral palsy. Normal initial gait or never normal loss of milestones like this toddler or Duchenne muscular dystrophy initially was able to walk and as he grow start to show weakness and inability to stand normally from a sitting position and using Gower maneuver. Ask the family if the child is able to bear weight or refusal to walk. This is serious. Very important to know that toddlers and the children play for living. This is their life. If they refuse to play or they refuse to stand or walk, this is serious. So any limp or gait disturbance should be taken seriously. During physical examination, observe the child for obvious distress or agitation, inconsolability, holding the extremity in a fixed position for comfort. This is serious. Assess the non-painful limb first. If able to bear weight, assess the pattern of limp. If favoring one leg or moving asymmetrically, focused examination with the child sitting and supine, trying to find the focus of distress and point of tenderness, neurovascular assessment like cases of compartment syndrome. Examine the child from head to toe. Examine the skin for rash or abnormal skin lesions. Positive finding may suggest reactive arthritis, Lyme disease, or even leukemia. 20% of cases of leukemia may present with limping or bone pain. Palpate the back for tenderness. Palpate the paraspinal muscles, spinous processes. Any toddler refusing to walk or stand, very important to keep discitis, osteomyelitis of the spine in differential. Palpate the iliac spines for tenderness. Examine the extremity in question after examining the unaffected one. Examine the extremity for erythema, swelling, ecchymosis, laceration or abrasions, range of motions at all the levels, joint by joint, hip joint, knee joint, ankle joint, and the foot. Take off the shoes and examine the foot. Differential diagnosis of limping in children according to the age. In toddlers less than 3 years of age, the possibilities are septic arthritis, osteomyelitis, myositis, discitis, very important to examine the spine always, transient synovitis, toddler fracture, neuromuscular disease, developmental dysplasia of the hip, neoplasm, metastatic disease like in cases of neuroblastoma or leukemia, foreign object in the knee or the foot. Limping between 3 and 10 years of age, possibilities are Perthes disease, transient synovitis, tumors, osteochondrosis, osteochondritis, desiccans, Osgood-Schlatter disease, stress fractures, osteomyelitis, leg length discrepancy. Adolescent or more than 10 years of age, possibilities are slip decapital femoral epiphysis, Perthes disease, juvenile idiopathic arthritis, overuse syndromes, for example, severe disease or Osgood-Schlatter disease, osteochondrosis, tumors, osteochondritis, desiccans, stress fracture, tarsal coalition, or painful flat foot. Delayed diagnosis of slip decapital femoral epiphysis, septic hip malignancy or spinal canal pathology is disastrous and can be associated with irreversible damage. Delay in the diagnosis of osteomyelitis, benign neoplasm, GIA or DDH is detrimental. Delay in the diagnosis of toddler fracture, Perthes disease, hemiplegia in the first visit is embarrassing but is unlikely to be associated with detrimental outcome. Investigations for a child with limp. Laboratory testing for a child with limping depending on the clinical presentation, and this may include CBC, erythrocyte sedimentation rate, CRP, blood culture, joint fluid studies. Very important to be familiar with Kusher criteria of septic hip, which is inability to ambulate and fever more than 101.3 Fahrenheit, and white blood cells more than 12,000, ESR more than 40, and CRP more than 2.5. This is considered septic hip. Plain radiographs are beneficial for most patients to rule out fracture. Infection can be seen in X-ray, such as periosteal reaction, but later neoplasm, congenital and developmental conditions. For example, DDH can be diagnosed with a plain X-ray in infants 6 months and older. Limitations of plain radiographs may not show subtle fracture acutely like cases of toddler fracture. It usually shows after 2 weeks. It changes secondary to infection takes time, takes about 7 to 10 days. So it's not a good option to diagnose osteomyelitis early with plain radiographs. Neoplasm may take long time. Young patient with less bone development, for example, cases of DDH, is not a good option to order X-ray to diagnose DDH in infants less than 6 months. Ultrasonography is an excellent study for a septic hip, deep soft tissue abscesses to identify foreign bodies, for example, splinters, plastic, or glass. CT scan can be helpful in cases of occult fracture, simple bone cysts, osteoid osteomas, non-ossifying fibromas. Very important to know the risk of radiation exposure when you order a CT scan for a child. It should be limited and used only if it's really needed and no other options. Use other alternative if possible. MRI with contrast is the best choice for diagnosing osteomyelitis and deep soft tissue infections including abscesses, fasciitis, myositis and pyomyositis, benign and malignant neoplasm of both soft tissue and bone, vascular abnormalities such as avascular necrosis of femoral head due to sickle cell disease or other causes. Limitations of MRI require sedation in younger children, limited availability in an emergency setting. I will give a quick review here of important causes of limping in children, and I will start with fractures. Toddler fractures are oblique fractures of the distal tibial shaft. Usually occurs between 9 months and 6 years of age after minimal trauma, trips, falls while playing or jumping. Clinical presentation, pain, refusal to walk or limping. Physical examination is essentially normal. There is no swelling, bruising or limb deformity. Initial radiographs are often negative, but you may see a faint oblique fracture or a spiral fracture in the distal tibial shaft. If the initial X-ray is negative, you may repeat the X-ray in 2 weeks and you will see the healing process or periosteal reaction. Management here is long leg walking cast for 2 to 3 weeks. If fracture presents late 2 weeks or more, there is no need to do casting unless symptoms are significant. Foot fractures are common in children because of twisting injuries, and this can cause non-displaced fractures of metatarsals and phalanges and limping. Look for point of tenderness, focal swelling and ecchymosis. Management of foot fractures non-displaced mostly with hard sole shoe is enough or sufficient, or casting in some cases. Stubbing of grade 2 can cause displaced fracture of grade 2 distal phalanx and nail bleeding, and this usually requires referral to a pediatric orthopedics for removal of the nail, irrigation and debridement with fracture reduction. Many children, they play around without footwear and they can suffer from puncture wounds and retained foreign bodies. This can be glass, plastic, splinters, wood, and this can present several days to weeks after the incident. And signs suggestive of a retained foreign body or a puncture wound, plantar cellulitis, draining laceration, induration with an underlying fluid collection. So it's very important to examine the foot for any child who is limping. X-ray or ultrasound, they can be diagnostic, and ultrasound can show the radiolucent foreign bodies. Management, antibiotic to cover for staph and strep, and follow up in 48 hours. If no improvement, consider Pseudomonas infection and provide IV antibiotics to cover for Pseudomonas, especially if the child was wearing a sneaker. Surgical exploration for removal of a large retained foreign body, especially foot, or not responding to local wound care and an antibiotic. Developmental dysplasia of the hip can cause limping, waddling gait, hip pain, early arthritis if it's not detected and treated early. The way to detect developmental dysplasia of the hip early by performing Barlow and Ortolani in infants less than 6 months. Barlow is positive if the head goes out the acetabulum, if you feel a clunk and you are able to dislocate the reduced hip and is well known as subluxable. And Ortolani is the opposite. If you are able to relocate the dislocated head back to acetabulum and you feel a clunk, this is considered positive. More than 6 months, if unilateral hip dysplasia, Galizi sign in this case will be positive, indicating unilateral short thigh segment. In bilateral cases, when they start to walk, waddling gait, the way to detect by imaging study, if the infant is 6 weeks and older, is sensitive to use hip ultrasound. Less than that is unreliable. Hip X-ray is beneficial if the infant is older than 6 months, because of ossification of the head of the femur will show an X-ray. Less than that is not helpful to do hip X-ray if the infant is less than 6 months. The treatment for developmental dysplasia of the hip depending on the age. In infants, usually you do splinting or abduction splinting by pelvic harness, and this for about 6 to 12 weeks. In older children between 6 and 18 months, you can use closed reduction and arthrogram in the operating room with placement of hip spica cast. In other cases or difficult cases, this can be done with open reduction. So a treatment and early detection of this case early is the key to prevent the early arthritis and the hip problem. Leg calviperthes disease is a vascular necrosis of the head of the femur in children between 4 and 12 years of age. The exact etiology is not known, but the proposed mechanism is trauma, hypercoagulability, genetics. Clinical presentation of leg calviperthes disease is limping, activity-related thigh pain or knee pain, and on physical exam, limited hip abduction and internal rotation. Diagnosis was with X-ray, AP, and frog leg lateral view. The treatment is conservative, like physical therapy, limit weight bearing, and non-steroidal surgical in selected cases. Another important cause of limping in children is slip decapital femoral epiphysis. Delayed in the diagnosis of this illness can cause osteonecrosis and degenerative joint disease. The typical presentation during adolescence between 12 and 13 years of age, more than half of the patients they are obese, so obesity is a risk factor. They present with groin pain, medial knee pain, or both. So if you have a patient presenting with knee pain and the knee exam is normal, very important to consider the hip as the source of the pain. Patient will hold the hip in external rotation and physical exam, limited internal rotation. So what to do next? Order a radiograph on the pelvis, AP, and frog lateral view, and draw a cline line along the superior femoral neck, and this should intersect the femoral epiphysis. If it's not, like in this case, this is a slip decapital femoral epiphysis. So immediately non-bearing weight on the affected side, provide crutches, walker, and bed rest, send to the ER for immediate referral to orthopedics and urgent treatment. This table is to summarize the difference between DDH perthes and slip decapital femoral epiphysis. In DDH, the presentation in toddlers less than 3 years of age is usually painless limp. And in older children, they may have vague activity-related discomfort due to leg length discrepancy. Positive Ortolani and Barlow signs in less than 6 months, more than 6 months if it's unilateral positive Galizi sign, which is a short thigh segment, and in bilateral cases, positive waddling wide gait. To confirm the diagnosis, hip ultrasound if it's less than 6 months, positive pelvis X-ray if it's more than 6 months. Referral to an orthopedic is required. For perthes disease, the presentation between 3 and 10 years of age with a painful limp and the pain located in the hip, thigh, or the knee, or both. And the physical examination limited hip motion, decreased internal rotation and abduction. The diagnosis with pelvis X-ray, AP, and frog lateral radiographs and referral to an orthopedic. For slip decapital femoral epiphysis, the presentation in older kids more than 10 years of age, they present with painful limp and the pain is located in the hip, thigh, or the knee, and physical examination will show limited hip motion, decreased internal rotation. Pelvis X-ray is diagnostic with AP and frog lateral radiographs, and this require an urgent referral to orthopedic surgeon. So as at least remember that DDH usually painless, and perthes and slip decapital femoral epiphysis, they are painful, and for slip decapital femoral epiphysis, they have to be referred immediately. If you have a child presenting with hip pain, limp, low-grade fever, preceding viral infection, normal or mild elevation of white blood cells, ESR and CRP, and white blood cell counts in joint fluid is less than 15,000, what is the most likely diagnosis? The most likely diagnosis is toxic synovitis or transient synovitis. On the other hand, if you have a child with hip pain, inability to ambulate, fever more than 101.3 Fahrenheit or 38.0 5 Celsius, elevation of white blood cells more than 12,000, ESR more than 40, and CRP more than 2.5, and joint fluid white blood cells more than 50,000, and more than 75% polymorph and a positive gram stain. The most likely diagnosis in this case is septic arthritis is the diagnosis of this case. Once this diagnosis is made or even suspected, immediate notification to pediatric orthopedic surgeon for surgical drainage and irrigation. Delay in the treatment or if urgent surgical drainage and irrigation is not undertaken in appropriate time, this can cause rapid and progressive joint destruction. While in case of toxic synovitis, the treatment is reassurance and ibuprofen or non-steroidal anti-inflammatory medications. This is a 5-year-old girl with limping more than 6 weeks. She has a swelling in her knees, gait disturbance, and the symptoms are better with activity and more prominent after a period of rest. Physical examination is significant for effusion and stiffness of knees. Has no detectable cause, normal ESR and CRP, and negative ANA. What is the most likely diagnosis? The most likely diagnosis is juvenile idiopathic arthritis or JIA. The diagnosis of juvenile idiopathic arthritis is based in history and physical examination. Chronicity of arthritis more than 6 weeks plus absence of other causes, this will make the diagnosis of juvenile idiopathic arthritis. So it is safely you can rule out the diagnosis of JIA in any child presenting with musculoskeletal pain and normal physical examination means no joint swelling, no effusion, and normal range of motion. This will make this diagnosis very unlikely. Also, very important to know that laboratory studies have little utility in making the diagnosis of JIA, except to exclude other causes of joint swelling. It is critical to know that pain almost never a prominent feature of the presentation of JIA. Compare that to acute rheumatic fever, where the joint is very painful and they have migratory arthritis. ESR and CRP, they are usually normal in cases of JIA, especially oligoarticular type. They can be elevated in systemic type. RF has no diagnostic value and ANA has no diagnostic value in making the diagnosis of JIA. ANA just can be helpful in prediction of uveitis or to determine the risk of uveitis in children with history of JIA. So, but it is very important to know this can be positive in 35% of healthy children. Lyme disease can cause limping in children. It is caused by Borrelia burgdorferi and it is transmitted by a tick bite. Northeast is the most common endemic areas. The earliest manifestation of this disease is a target lesion or erythema migrans. So very important to know if you have a child presenting with erythema migrans living in an endemic area and there is a history of tick bite or tick exposure, this child has to be treated with no delay, with no investigations. Constitutional symptoms, low-grade fever, chills, headache, malaise, and fatigue or flu-like symptoms. Other manifestations like Bell's palsy, carditis, meningitis, arthritis. Investigations if the diagnosis is not clear, Lyme titers, and if positive, confirm with Western blot. Treatment, antibiotics, for example, doxycycline, children 8 years and above, less than that, amoxicillin. IV antibiotics like severe cases, for example, meningitis, they must receive IV antibiotics, for example, ceftriaxone. Overuse syndromes. Oscutus-Schleyder disease is one of the overuse syndrome because of repetitive traction of quadriceps muscles on the tibial tubercle. This can cause traction apophysitis or osteochondrosis. This is common during the period of rapid growth and activity, combination of both together. This is usually between 9 and 14 years of age, more common in males than females simply because males they do more sports than females. Slight limp, this can be the presentation, but more common pain in the tibial tuberosity area that is worse with activity and better with rest. On physical examination, tenderness or swelling in the tibial tubercle. The treatment is icing after exercise 15 to 20 minutes 3 times a day. A limitation of activity that causing pain, but no exclusion of sports, usually not required. Non-steroidal anti-inflammatory medication may help and usually advised to be used after activity, not before, because this can mask the pain and make it worse. Stretching and strengthening exercise of quadriceps and hamstring muscle to decrease the traction on the tibial tubercle. Advise the patients to warm and stretch before exercising. This will help to prevent this illness and also icing after exercise. Severe disease is similar to Osgood-Schlatter disease, is overuse syndrome, but different location. It's because of repetitive traction of Achilles tendon in the heel, and this will cause calcaneal apophysitis or inflammation in the heel. This is commonly present between 7 and 9 years of age, more common in males who are doing sports with running and jumping. They will present with heel pain and a limp and toe walking that worsens with activity and better with rest. Ankle dorsiflexion will cause pain and will be limited, and radiographs are not indicated in this disease except if the diagnosis is not clear and you consider other causes, for example tumor. Treatment is icing, limitation of activity causing pain, stretching of Achilles tendon, non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs may help, and also heel cups may help as well. Osteochondritis dissecans can cause knee pain and limping in children. It is most likely because of repetitive microtrauma, and this can cause avascular necrosis and the separation of osteochondral fragment. The clinical presentation, medial knee pain, worse with activity and followed by swelling and limited motion. If the fragment is separated or displaced, this can cause catching and locking. The physical exam, medial femur tenderness or effusion. The x-ray, the most sensitive view is notch or tunnel view. MRI, if the x-ray is negative. Management, avoidance of high impact exercise like jumping and running until the pain goes away and the x-ray looks normal. Knee immobilizer or crutches until pain-free. Strengthening and range of motion exercise. Surgery in a high-grade injuries. Common benign tumors. Osteochondroma is a common benign lesion, well known as exostosis as well. Commonly located in the distal femur or proximal tibia. The presentation is a painless mass, and if it's painful because of repeated trauma and or the mechanics of the mass. The physical exam will show non-tender fixed mass, and the range of motion of the adjacent joint may be affected, and this can cause limp. The next is osteoma, is a common benign bone tumor as well. A common location, tibia and femur. The presentation between age of 5 and 20 years of age, this is the most common. They may present with limping. Pain is common as well, constant pain that may be worse at night, and usually relieved with anti-inflammatory medication. And in x-ray, you will see area of dense reactive bone surrounding radiolucent nidus, and this requires referral to an orthopedic surgeon. Malignant tumors can cause bone pain and limping, dull pain, rapidly enlarging mass like in this case of osteosarcoma, pathological fracture like in this case of leukemia. Night pain is common but is not experienced by all patients. Very important not to be missed. Growing pains are a common cause of knee pain in children. It is a diagnosis of exclusion. It is believed to be a type of stress injury. Common between preschool and school age, bilateral intermittent extremity pain means no specific location, pain occurring during the evening, pain may awaken the child from sleep, resolves by the morning. Does not limit physical activity or activity during the day. Physical examination is normal. So it is very important to know about growing pains, the pain at night or in the evening, not during the day, does not interfere with physical activity. Never limping. This is very important, very critical to know. Never limping. The treatment is reassurance, ice, heat, massage, anti-inflammatory medications. These examples are not growing pain and must be investigated. For example, localized the bone pain or swelling, bone pain during the day and at night, bone pain interferes with activity or associated with limp, associated with systemic symptoms, for example, fever, fatigue, pallor, and weight loss. So very important to consider possible underlying disorders. Summary and algorithm for evaluating a child with limping. If you have a child with non-antalgic gait or if the limping is not painful, evaluate if it's toe walking, Trendelenburg gait or circumduction. If circumduction, order AP, radiograph of bilateral lower extremities. If the radiograph is negative, consider cerebral palsy or knee stiffness. Measure the length difference between both legs. If it's positive, this will be the cause of the circumduction leg length discrepancy. If Trendelenburg gait, order AP and the frog radiograph of the pelvis. If the pelvis radiograph is negative, the possibilities are muscular dystrophy or cerebral palsy. In a child with Trendelenburg-gait, the pelvis X-ray will be positive in cases of slip decapital femoral epiphysis, developmental dysplasia of the hip, or Perthes disease. Limping without pain and toe walking if there is no spasticity, the most likely underlying cause is idiopathic toe walking. If it is associated with spasticity or exaggerated reflexes, the most likely underlying cause is cerebral palsy. If you have a child with toe walking and there is a leg length difference, the possibilities are developmental dysplasia of the hip, congenital short femur, or congenital short tibia. If the limping is painful or antalgic gait, the approach is different. Very important to differentiate if it is non-infectious-like or infectious-like. Clinical signs are suggestive non-infectious-like, recent history of trauma, no fever, no chills, point of tenderness or point tender, and well appearing. Laboratory values suggestive non-infectious causes of painful limping are normal CRP, normal ESR, and normal white blood cells. If cannot focus examination means if you cannot determine the location of the problem, order bone scan to focus further evaluation. If focused pain over an extremities, order plain radiograph. If the radiograph is negative, order MRI if it's still high index of suspicion. If the radiograph is positive, treat and manage the case. On the other hand, if the painful limping is infectious-like, from the clinical signs, for example, recent history of cold, fever, chills, erythema, ill-appearing, and from laboratory values, elevated CRP, ESR, and white blood cells, this is suggestive of infectious causes. If cannot focus examination, order bone scan to focus further evaluation. In case of focus pain and erythema on an extremity, order a plain radiograph. If the radiograph is negative, order MRI if it's still high index of suspicion. If it's positive, treat osteomyelitis. So if you have a child with painful limp and the clinical signs and laboratory values are suggestive of infectious causes and on physical examination decrease the range of motion of any joint and swelling, perform joint aspiration. If joint aspiration is negative, the most likely cause is transient synovitis or juvenile idiopathic arthritis. If it's positive, this is septic arthritis. This has to be managed immediately. This is the end of this presentation. Thank you for listening. This video is only for educational purpose and not intended to direct the care of any specific patient. Please consult your physician or the physician of your child for the correct diagnosis and the proper treatment. None of my videos can be superior or an alternative for the opinion of an experienced and licensed healthcare professional. Thank you again.